Hi everyone, and welcome to this session about the impact of COVID in the sports world, and more precisely in the industry of sports law. We will discuss early about the impact that has had both in the practice of sport, international sports lawyer, how this practice has been deeply affected by the COVID pandemic, which started unfortunately 2 years ago in December 2021, it will be 2 years since the pandemic started, and how we have tried to cope with the effects of the pandemic, both from a legal perspective, trying to adapt regulations, bylaws, and the work we were doing in a different way to these new times, and also how it has affected our personal practice, meaning like how hearings or trials have changed, how we have to adapt to have video calls, video arbitration, rather than presential court hearings, which was something new for most of us, because some bodies, just a handful of them, had already video arbitration and video hearings. And also how I won't say the workflow, but the way we work from home, that is quite different. Also the interaction with clients, with clubs, with partners has changed a lot. Fortunately, right now we are moving a little bit forward. We are moving to new and brighter times. I know there are many people from all around the world, and I appreciate you here. I appreciate your questions, which we'll try to answer all of them, or most, if we don't have enough time at the end of the session, but some interesting questions that may help us to articulate the debate, maybe even answer during this conversation we'll have with my colleague, Agustin. So I will present myself. I am Juan Crespo. I am the director of the Sports Law LLM program online version at the Universidad Europea Real Madrid. And I think it's the perfect moment to have an online program. Why? Because we have seen that travel is difficult. Getting visas to go to other countries is difficult. Even within the European Union, it's hard sometimes to cope with all the different areas, all the different color zones, like, okay, now your country's in green area, you can go, all that. So that's why we decide, amongst other reasons, to have an online program, because it helps both in the difficult times in which we have seen everything changes to continue to get the formation, to continue learning and challenging ourselves. Also, this program is made for all of you who have already perhaps a senior position, a club or the law firm, or you're willing to have more studies in your career, but don't have the time to attend or to travel to different locations to attend a master. And that's why we have created this program, which I particularly like, because it's when we have the first edition this year, and I think we can call us a small sports law family, because we are almost every day taking care of each other, trying to see where the students need to improve, what we can do for them, giving them new materials. And this kind of personal touch is what I'm proud to be achieving with this program. And I hope I will be seeing some of you in the future for the 2022 edition. So without much ado, further ado to that, I will introduce my colleague, Agustin, a legal expert and sports lawyer from one of the most well-known law firms in the field of sports in the world. And I will ask him a few questions about how personally has been impacted by the COVID pandemic from a personal perspective, and then some like situations he might have encountered when dealing with clubs and how they have been coping with the effects of the pandemic, how they have been trying to change contract, how FIFA and other regulators, all the governing bodies, have been trying to issue emergency regulations that were trying to solve somehow the situation. And also we will deal with a topic, it's some kind of fresh topic, even though pandemic, we have been talking about that for, as I said before, almost 2 years, but there is a brand and fresh topic, which is a topic of a ban to the travel, to some international travel of players. And I'm talking precisely about the example of the match Argentina against Brazil, which was played, I'm sorry for the dates, was played like, maybe Agustin knows that, two, 3 weeks ago, in which, yes, because of some immigration law, players coming from the UK, which was kind of, let's say, in a yellow list for Brazilian health authorities, weren't allowed to travel to Brazil. So they say, okay, people playing from Argentina, which were playing for English Premier League clubs, you are not able to be filled. And that made like an investigation by FIFA. We will see how everything would end. But it's a problem because now some federations, some representative teams maybe face challenges that they wouldn't expect, like that one, like, okay, you cannot call up some of your players. You cannot field them because they come from countries that, according to the country where the match is going to take place, they are not allowed because of some immigration, travel, health restriction. I think it's a really important, fresh topic that helped us to go beyond the regular questions about the pandemic and its impact in sports law, like force majeure, breach of contract, all these kind of things. So, Agustin, thank you for being here. And I will be asking you the first question is, for a personal point of a legal practitioner in the field of sports law, who has been your practice impacted by COVID?
Well, thank you, Juan. First of all, it's a pleasure for me to be here with the friends of Escuela Universitaria Real Madrid, Universidad Europea. And as in the vast majority of the works, our job has changed in the sense that most of our contacts with clients or during trials or hearings has been changed in the sense that you cannot travel, you cannot meet with clients directly, so you have to use the technological tools in order to supply these points. Obviously, we managed to continue and to carry on all the process that we have, and in fact our work has been increased due to this situation because a lot of clubs have problems, economic problems or financial complicated situation due to the COVID pandemic. So the volume and the level of work has been increased. But we manage all the lawyers that are involved in international sports law manage to continue and to finish these proceedings, although some of them has been stopped during a long period due to the fact that some of them required an personal hearing. But at the end, the vast majority of this proceeding has been resolved with a video conference hearing. That obviously is not the same. Lawyers have the impression that if you don't have this direct contact with the members of the panel or even the judge, if you are involved in a national court, or the possibility to make the interrogation of the witnesses directly, something is lost during the process, and you know that the screen is to call. And sometimes the strategy or the possibilities that are available for a lawyer cannot be used at the 100% of the possibilities. But life continues, and you know that now things are changing, and we have the possibility to start traveling again. And I hope that everything will go to the old-fashioned way, and we can meet with clients and have this personal contact that, in my opinion, cannot be substituted by these technological tools that obviously are very useful, but cannot substitute at the 100% some part of our work.
I think it's a really interesting point, the ones you were raising, Agustin. We want to talk about all the tricks a lawyer can do while we are on the video hearing, because you cannot see where your hands are. You can be texting someone during the hearing, all this kind of thing. We won't talk about the kind of trick. But I think this important, like this personal touch with the client, this personal touch even with our colleagues defending the interests of other parties, is something that is getting lost in this kind of, well, I won't say got lost in translation, because I mean it's lost by the virtual. And also where you were pointing also before, there's sometimes some technical difficulties, people living in countries where access to some internet platforms are not the best. So they, in order to have these kind of hearings, we need to prepare it in advance, check if everything is correct. It's something that wouldn't happen if we have a presidential hearing. But also, and here I will disagree with you, I think even if we don't like it, video hearings have arrived here and they will remain because it saves a lot of cost for some of the parties, mainly for appealing parties who have to pay costs, all that. So personal point of view is kind of polemic, but also I will ask you if you have missed somehow the all these kind of events of networking we have had in the past, like, you know, International Law Congress, where people share their opinions, where voices can be heard, not only by sports lawyers, but also by members of the full family, stakeholders, where some decisions are being, how to say that, are being decided, because we have seen, and this is something polemical, and I know maybe it's going to be recorded, so I won't be able to deny I said that, but we have seen recently a lot of polemic issues. I've seen Super League, we have seen, and we will mention later, the international match calendar. We'll see all these kind of things that has been always answered by media statements, replying that someone said something on the media, and because there was an impossibility of traveling to some place to meet together, to gather in order to make a decision, I see an increase in this kind of conflicts. I don't know if you have seen that, or at least you have experienced this in a time which everything seems easier and we can reach out to people in other corner of the globe. I have seen also an increase in some conflicts because it's always harder, as you were pointing out, to solve things when you cannot see the other party face to face.
Well, as you said, it's obvious that these technology advances and these tools are very, very worthy to keep in contact persons that it's impossible that they get in personal contact, for instance, clients that are in South America, and we are in Europe, and it's impossible just to have a personal meeting, just to comment a case or have an advice. But it's true that during these personal meetings and during these appointments of the stakeholders in any organization, the background of the meeting and the network that is behind the scene is always very useful, because not always everything can be explained or put in a screen, and sometimes very important to have this personal approach. I want to insist that these technologies are here to stay and obviously are very useful for several reasons. First of all, the democratization of the access of justice, because the cost has reduced. You save the cost of the travels and another cost that are involved. And on the other side, you have the possibility to stay or to get access to different trials or proceedings that in another case would be impossible to gather all the parties. But it's true that, for instance, this morning I have been in a meeting in a federation, and we had a previous meeting by Teams, by this tool. And it's true that today, this morning, we arrived, the three parties at the meeting arrived to the conclusion that we had a clear picture of the problem, much more clear than in the video conference, because always in the near contact, in the personal contact, always something arises, always a question that is possible that during the conference too, but the personal contact always offers something more. So in the future, I think that a combination of both possibilities would be the best, and obviously take advantage of this experience in order to improve our services and the way in which we get in contact with clients or the bodies of any sports organization.
Thank you, Agustin. I think you raised a really good point, which will help me to talk again about the democratization of sports law, which is always achieved by many ways. And one of these ways is Carson, for example, here, an online master, because it enables you to follow top-tier lecturers from across all the corners of the globe. And now we will enter into more like legal topics, because I'm sure, and I know that you have come across many cases dealing with breach of contract without just cause, means that one of the parties didn't have a cause that enables that party to terminate a contract. And many of these during the COVID, let's say the height of the COVID epidemic in April, May, June, March 2020, was a lot of clubs saying, okay, first of all, we will try to cover costs, we'll try to reduce salaries, reduce our costs, but then, okay, and in some developing countries, I'm sorry for saying that, but it happened more in Europe, it has happened, but there were some social security mechanism to cover this loss, also some collective bargaining agreements reached to do that. But in other developing countries, the clubs say, okay, we are losing money, we are going to stop playing some of the players, saying that in my country, X, there is a force majeure situation that enables me not to pay salaries. So, Agustin, I don't want you to disclose any names to say, okay, these clubs in this country have done this, but to say, how have you faced these situations and whether you have defended both the clubs and players, and how was your experience from that?
This is a very interesting point, because the experience of this time of the pandemic has taught us that we need the try to use our efforts to arrive to agreements. And in fact, this is our job sometimes to frame and to give shape to the agreements of the parties. But indeed, in this case of the pandemic, it was absolutely important. And in fact, if you have a look to the guidelines that have been passed or approved by FIFA and also by BAT, that has a very interesting document that I recommend our friends to have just a look to this.
Sorry, Agustin, just in case because maybe some of the viewers are familiarized with BAT, but some of them maybe not. So maybe you would like to explain how BAT function and how you can trace a parallelism with BAT and CAS, just in case some of our audience are not familiar with that.
The BAT is the Basketball Arbitral Tribunal that belongs to FIBA and is constituted in order to resolve fundamentally the claims that arise from the professional contracts between players and clubs around the world. And this document is quite interesting because, first of all, encourages the parties to give priority to amicable settlements and to use bona fides, and also establishes some guidelines that would be taken into account by arbitrators in case of a future claim related to COVID pandemic. But it's very important to highlight that these guidelines itself is stating that arbitrators will take into account very seriously the efforts made by the parties in order to act in good faith, in order to try to adjust the contracts to the situation. So the following guidelines that are referred to the lockout periods of leagues during the periods that there was no competition establishes some criteria in order to try to adapt or to adjust these contracts to the situation. But in this with this proposal, it's very important that that lawyers and the people that is involved with sport law have this intention to try to, through good faith, try to arrive to an adjustment. And this is the experience shown that the most of the cases, for instance in Spain, that we have experienced, has been addressed through collective agreements with the players of the first team, at least, in order to adjust the loss of the clubs due to this time of suspension of the competitions and the fact that the people is not the public is not at the stadiums, and the problem with the decrease of the incomes of the clubs, trying to adjust these contracts to this new reality that we have to face. As you know, most of the sports events has been affected. You know that the Olympics has been postponed, and the vast majority of the national domestic sports sporting leagues and competition has been even cancelled, as it was the case in the French and Dutch leagues, and five European football leagues has been suspended during a long time. So the problems arose with the imbalance between the incomes of the clubs and the expected incomes of this projected season and the reality and the need to adjust the salaries and overall the remuneration of the contracts to this situation where, for instance, players cannot play before public or even cannot train because of the health orders or instruction of the public authority. So I would like to, the same as Bad May, FIFA encourages the parties or the stakeholders in order to arrive to agreement. So this is the word, I think, of the that the experience gives, the need to adjust these contracts to this new situation. And for the future, it's important to have into account that this would be no longer new. I mean, in the future, if there's any, I hope that no, but in any modification of the COVID or is any other form or expression of the pandemic, it would be for the parties and for the lawyers to provide these situations in order to establish, for instance, that the contracts will continue until the competition ends and not just ends to a certain date. That has been the problem with some of the contracts, and overall to establish some criteria in order to adjust the salaries or the remuneration of the players according to this possible, that I hope that will not occur in the future, but these possible situations. So first of all, agreements, and secondly, we already have the experience, so we cannot blame on the pandemic in the future that we didn't provide for this new situation. No, in the future, this situation will be no longer new, so we have to take this into account. It's very important.
I think you raised quite a few good points that we are going to go through each of them. First of all, I bet you have also seen in old new contracts really detailed force majeure clauses that were like that in the past, because in the past you always, for all of you in the audience who have been studying in a civil law country, have always read in our old civil books like epidemics, pandemics, floods and natural disasters, and we say, okay, this is something written by people from the 19th century. It's a funny thing, but it's not going to happen to us. It happened, and we were mostly prepared. Then it was also a little bit challenging for everyone in each European country, in all over the world. But I think this is going to change a little bit. How contracts have been drafted, how are we paying close attention to force majeure issues, how is going to revolutionize a little bit this particular aspect of civil law and liability, etc. Also, I would say you were pointing out something interesting, like how sports stakeholders, let's say FIBA, FIFA, whoever, handball, they release guidelines to try to harmonize the really chaotic world of every single member of these organizations. It's a country or a special territory like Scotland or Wales in football or rugby. So you have to harmonize this pyramidal structure of sports in which FIFA orders its member association to follow a set of rules that they have, but these national associations need also to comply with some mandatory national regulations. So you have this conflict, and that's why sometimes FIFA said, okay, we didn't said COVID was a force majeure issue. We said only that it should be dealt applying the national law of the country to try to not put themselves in a difficult situation. This is an interesting point. how we have this conflict between private law sphere of sports law, the public law sphere of sports law, and administrative law. And then you also mentioned a really important point at the beginning of your commentary, when you say about reaching agreements. I think it's a really important point. It's something that during this year, I'm always try to bomb with information the students of the program, saying, okay, negotiation is one of the most important skills of a lawyer, a sports lawyer, and a good human being, because it helps you to understand the other's position and try to reach a win-win situation, or at least a non-sum-zero situation in which one of the parties is going to lose much more than the other. So I think it's important always to negotiate, to try to make some time, eventually claims, appeals will arrive, because sometimes negotiation is not enough to change a situation, to try to reshape it. But if we can, we will, and more in these kind of difficult times, is a better way. And finally, there is something here Augustine was also hinting during his presentation, that is the difference between you have team sports and individual sports. I also was saying, like, some events where like hit really hard. For example, we have some of the Grand Slam that were some events that were canceled. For example, the under 17, under 19, UEFA women's and men's championship, and you have Wimbledon, which had a anti-pandemic insurance, which was pretty worth it because it helped them to recover some of the money. But my point is, you have also to deal with individual athletes whose main source of income is their individual performance. They don't have a club paying them. Sometimes they have sponsors, they can pay them for a few months, but if they don't play tennis tournaments, if they don't fight in judo or taekwondo or karate events, they will lose an important source of their income and also of the media brand awareness, because they are not being exposed to the public. I think this is something important. And I don't know, Augustine, if you would like to complete some of these points, or I will bomb you with the next question.
Yes, as you said before, we have to try to provide all the situations, but this is impossible. For instance, you can provide the situation of a future pandemic effect or the suspension of a competition in the contracts, but for instance, as you mentioned before, the question of the match between Brazil and Argentina. And in fact, this is a combination of situations that you have on one side, the fact that the players have to inform when they arrive to Brazil or to the Brazil authorities, the fact that they have been in several countries that are likely to be affected by some of the forms of the pandemic. So they have to inform if they have been in the United Kingdom, India, Northern Ireland, South Africa, etc. And the combination with the political situation in Brazil, where it seems that the authorities had to show that they are much more strict and clean than in any other country, so they are so strict that they stop a match, although it has been initiated. And the future consequences of these players, that when they come back to United Kingdom, they will have to pass a quarantine. They had to stay in a quarantine, and during this period, they cannot train with their mates and cannot play matches. So it's impossible always to provide all the situations. Our obligation as lawyers is try to do this, to provide all the situations, but obviously there always will be a combination of, as in this case, of situations that provide a complicated scenario to face up with this. But other cases, as you mentioned before, that the individual players is a different stuff, obviously, because they depend on the sports events. And as you know, during the pandemic, most of the live sports events has been cancelled. So this implies that the losses of these events due to the cut or the debated incomes of the broadcasters has a clear influence. So that that part of the sport reality is not much more complicated to be adjusted to the situation. It's just you cannot change these points. You cannot arrange with the organizers because just the event is cancelled. So it's much more different. But as long as we can, we have to think about all the situations and the possible secondary effects of for instance, this movement of players to other countries. You have a very different situation of football in different countries. For instance, here in Spain, you have the stadiums at the 40% of the assistance. In contrast, you have full stands in England or empty stadiums in South America, and you have quarantines in some destinations and PCR in other countries. So it's very different to have all the circumstances into account, but we have to make an effort, at least as sports lawyers, in order to advise overall clubs and players in order to provide or to prevent this problem, so at least that this problem has been solved in a previously and agreed manner.
Yes, I totally agree with you. I think the good labor, the good work of the lawyer, it's shown by the way he always tried to reach to our agreements, or to bring together the interests of his party to the interest of the other party, and to reach this kind of win-win agreement. And this can only be made through dialogue and a well knowledge of the situation involved. And this means in the world of sports to try to put all stakeholders together to try to reach a solution, because this impacted football law and also the revenue of clubs, the individual situation of athletes, everything. And it has drastically changed the way a little bit that people thought about sports. And many after the Champions League in 2020, which we have this kind of express Champions League playing the final eight format, many people were saying, okay, we would like to have this format again because it was pretty cool. Sorry, I think I had some problem with the micro. So, Agustin, I'm going to ask you a little bit like the devil's advocate, a question that may be a little bit tricky to answer. So feel free not to answer it. But if you were a sports governing body or this kind of, let's say, you were in a position of power, able to dictate and to draft regulations, what would you have changed during the worst moments of the pandemic, if you can say something?
Mm-hmm. Well, in my opinion, and precisely as you mentioned before, the main problem here is you have competition issues that can be resolved by the sports governing bodies, but the main problem is are the professional contracts. And as you mentioned before, the professional contracts depends in the most of the countries depend on the national law. For instance, here in Spain, you don't have the possibility to adapt or to take any decisions disregarding the national law about work, employment contracts, and overall the special relationship of athletes or professional athletes. And for instance, in case of the suspension of a competition, you can consider the suspension of the contracts. In case you have a decrease in your incomes, a substantial decrease in your incomes, you can use other tools. That is, for instance, they try to make a reduction of the time frame of the workers in order to reduce the salaries in a proportional way. You have different tools, but you have to adapt to the law or the collective agreement in every country. So I think that FIFA made as much as it could in the sense that gave these guidelines, trying to give some principles, some suggestions or recommendations to be followed by the national leagues or federations and the stakeholders in the different countries. FIFA took the decisions that that it can to take, in, for instance, in order to allow that players can play for three clubs in the same season, as you know, and even to be fielded in these three teams as a special circumstance due to the to the. To the crisis of the pandemic and the circumstance that some players have to change clubs because of the of the of the suspension or cancellation of the national competitions in different countries, so that they have to look for other other clubs, or the regulations about the modification of the transfer windows that were adapted to the fact that that some national or domestic competition has been suspended, so they finished in a later moment that the previously that they were supposed to do. So I in my opinion, FIFA made what it could, that was to take the regulatory decisions in order to adjust the international legal frame to the situation, and then to encourage and to give some guidelines in order to have these general principles in the national sphere, in the national scope, in order to try to help the different countries in order to solve these problems. You have the problem of the players that that have a contract that expire in a certain date, but the competition goes on due to this temporary suspension. You have the problem with players that have another a further contract with other club, possibly in another country, and the competition has not still finished. And you had the problem with these players that are on loan in other clubs, and the competition, as in the same situation, has been extended due to the pandemic situation. So the idea of FIFA is to give some guidelines, but they cannot impose this solution. So in my opinion, with these guidelines, they made all the things that they can do in this sense. And in my opinion, both governing bodies, FIFA and FIBA, FIBA through the Basketball Arbitral Tribunal, take this decision in a very immediate way. They take this decision in April 2020, and I think that they reacted in a very quick way.
Thanks, Agustin. I think I heard the name Messi. Even you didn't spoke it up, but it seems they were perhaps referring to this famous case in the summer of 2020. And here it will come my last question after what you said. What do you think are going to be some of the changes brought in by COVID that are going to remain in place?
Well, you know that, for instance, in Spain, there has been financial difficulties for many clubs, and there has been an adjustment of fair play regulations, for instance, in the scope of La Liga, and a lot of clubs have the necessity to adjust the salary costs of the. For instance, in the case that is very, very well known, is the case of Barcelona, that due to a previous situation and the problems with pandemic, they have a huge huge losses and have real problems to keep their stars. So they have to reduce the salary cap in order to respect the La Liga regulations. And I think that from a legal point of view, you had this when the pandemic appeared in the international sport scenario. This was something new. We have to deal with this situation. But now, and as I mentioned before, it's something that is not more no longer new. So we have to take into account that these things happen, and we have to try to provide the situation in contracts, because in the future, it's possible that a governing body or an arbitrator will say, look, you knew that this could happen and you didn't provide any provision in the contract, so you have to carry with the consequences of your lack of diligence in order to draft the contract, overall if you're a club. So in my opinion, this is the most important consequence. The pandemic, we still are suffering the consequences all around the world, but in the future, this will be no longer something new. So we have to take into account in any contract, although things have come to something more normal, as the old normality, as I mentioned, but no one knows if, I hope that no, but in another way or another possibility or form of the pandemic come again, or other pandemic.
Finger crossed.
Yeah, so we have to expect that no, but as a lawyer, we cannot say, look, this is force majeure. We cannot expect this. Now we have to expect this and to provide the tools in order to adapt the contracts to this possible situation.
Excellent. Fair enough, Agustin. So before going to, if anyone in the audience has some questions for us, I will say, like, it's important to, if you're interested in the field of sports law, it's important to form yourself with practitioners, not that have like a solid legal background, but also with experience in dealing with cases of all sorts. Agustin and other excellent legal practitioners are going to be in the roster of the 2022 edition of the International Sports Law LLM program at the University of Europe in Real Madrid. So as we say on the chat on YouTube, feel free to send us an email requesting more information. We will be more than happy to provide that to you. And I think now is a good moment, after all the pandemic, after this time of crisis, to ponder it a bit and to think about whether you want to pursue your passion or not. And I think the online mechanism, which is a little bit hard when it comes to hearings, all these kind of things, but I think it's an excellent tool to improve yourself and to learn new things, because it permits you to attend lectures and to work at your own pace. I think it's something important. So after this small digression, and after, if I will see has any further comment, I will ask you, if you have any question, which I will read on the chat browser open on YouTube. So please feel free to ask any question that comes to your mind, and we will try to answer it at our best of the capabilities. Thank you. And don't be shy. I know sometimes it's hard when you have to write rather than to speak out, but I think any question would be welcome. And as we always said, there are not stupid questions, but a stupid question that are not asked, which is different. So feel free about sports in general, about the program, about the COVID situation. Thank you. We will give you like some time, some room for making and writing down these questions. Okay, it seems we had a really, really shy audience, which is not a problem. And if I meet some of you in the future, and I hope so in the program, I hope you will lose some of the shyness and engage in conversation. But as we mentioned, you have here the address of the university, and I will write down my own personal... I cannot write a message because I am not connected to YouTube. But if you look on the internet for our law firm, Ruth Huerta and Crespo Sports Lawyers, you will find our contact details from both of Agustin's and mine. So feel free, and also university will have more information if you need that. So again, thanks to Rosario Pedro Madrid for the time for this session. I think it was pretty instructive. Also, I highly appreciate Agustin's time and dedication and insights about this complicated and ever-changing world. And also thanks to, and last but not least, thank you to all who attend the event. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you got some meaningful insights. And we are here to help you out. That we are here to provide you more information if needed. Thank you, and I hope to see you around in the sports law industry. Take care and have a nice evening, morning, or night, depending where you are located. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.